start with. So the Executive Board of the International Olympic Committee today expressed its ongoing extreme concern with the grave situation within the International Boxing Association and its current governance. This includes the circumstances of the establishment of the election list and the misleading communication within the IEBA membership regarding the IOC's position. Such behaviour is affecting not just the reputation of IEBA and boxing, but of sport in general. Therefore, the IOC reiterates its clear position that if the governance issues are not properly addressed to the satisfaction of the IOC at the forthcoming IEBA conference, the existence of boxing on the Olympic programme and even the recognition of IEBA as an international federation recognised by the IOC are under threat. At the same time, we would like to reassure the athletes that the IOC will, as it always has done in such situations and is currently doing at the Youth Olympic Games Buenos Aires 2018, will do its utmost to ensure that the athletes do not have to suffer under these circumstances and that we will protect their Olympic dream. And as I say, I think there's a statement coming around, so you don't have to take notes. I think that's the main announcement today, but I'll also run through a couple of the other bits and pieces. So the EB discussed the need for the IOC to create a high-level advisory body on human rights and sports within the IOC. Will be aligned with the IOC's long-term strategic approach. The EB held initial discussions and decided that a further proposal regarding the creation of a human rights and sports high-level advisory group will be presented at the December EB in Tokyo. YOG 2022, the EB, as you know, will propose Senegal as the single candidate country to host the next summer Youth Olympic Games in 2022, to be still ratified by the IOC session, of course. Senegal has the full support from the highest authorities in the country. The IOC will assist Dakar and Senegal in the same spirit of co-construction that has already begun elsewhere and will continue with that co-construction. IBU, International Biathlon Union, the EB noted the positive steps taken by the IBU to address actions required by the IOC earlier this year. Also notes the importance of the commitments needed from the newly elected IBU President Ole Dahlin to the full and further implementation of these changes. It's important that the new president ensures his commitment to further implementation of changes within the sport in order to take biathlon into an era of greater transparency and good governance. And until that happens, the direct financial payments will not resume until those changes have been made to our satisfaction. Very briefly on wrestling, IWF, the EB notes the positive work that's been done and expects a report back to the EB in December, again, around governments and the review of their anti-doping work by an independent working group. GIFS, Global Association of International Sports Federations, EB approved the presentation of GIFS at the session for full recognition. So it will be, again, we'll go to the session for the full recognition. One more for our Japanese colleagues. The EB also approved the presentation of International Sumo Federation to the IOC session for full recognition later this week, as the IF has worked hard to improve governance and strategic planning and now meets all the criteria necessary. There was a discussion of Olympic Agenda 2020's new norm. As you know, it was already partially applied in Pyeongchang, where its implementation allowed for a number of changes that saved money and facilities. So accredited seats were cut down. The mountain IBC was eliminated. Some of the measures. New norm has largely been applied also in Tokyo, with 49 measures already in place. With more to come, we've already seen considerable savings, including the $2.2 billion following the review of the venue master plan in 2014, and subsequently hundreds of millions of dollars in additional OCOG and non-OCOG budget savings, which will be communicated in the coming days. Sorry? Okay. Will be more measures, obviously, in Beijing. And then just to give you an idea for 2026, that's guiding us through the new norm measures. And this has resulted in them proposing approximately 80% of existing venues compared to 60% on average for candidatures in 2018 and 2022. So you see it's actually having having an effect, and also on the proposed budgets are now down 15% compared with previous occasions. For those that are interested, EB approved two nationality changes. Jordan Kirby will change from cycling will change from Australian to New Zealand nationality, and as usual the IFs and NOCs were all in agreement with those changes. And one other, Dominika Vadurova in sailing, changed from Slovakian to Czech Republic nationality. And then finally, there was a presentation on the Olympism in Action Forum, which you've all seen will be taking place later this week. 1,600 participants from the Olympic movement, of course, but also from civil society. And you will see in many of the sessions some considerable critics of the IOC will be taking part. So I urge you to go along. It should actually be some interesting conversations about the future of sport. So there we are. There's a long list. Happy to take questions. Duncan.
Duncan McKay, Inside the Game. Can I just check about the statement, Mark, about boxing? Are you saying that you will try your best to keep boxing on the programme but not recognise AIBA as the organisers of that tournament? Or are you saying its place is still in jeopardy?
The place is in jeopardy at the moment. But what we're saying, I don't want to be... This is not for quoting, but more for kind of... Just to give you guidance of what we're saying there is that we will work to make sure the athletes can still take part in some way. What that will be yet... I mean, it's still a hypothetical because we're waiting for the Congress, which I think is on the 3rd of November... of AIBA. So we're waiting for that before we take further action. But what we're saying is we will work to make sure, as we have done here, by the way, for the youth athletes, to make sure that they can still compete. As you know, a number of senior members of the of AIBA have not been accredited here, and there is independent oversight of the results system here. So we're working to make sure that the athletes won't have their chance to compete taken away from them. So, more clear? Wakako.
Thank you. Wakako Iki from Yomiuri. Just to follow up, Duncan's. On the side of Tokyo's preparation for boxing, would there be any change with or without AIBA being recognized officially?
Well, as I say, I mean, I think the statement hopefully makes it clear that we will continue to work towards making sure, hoping to make sure that athletes can still take part in Tokyo. How that will be, I think we have a month until the Congress of AIBA, but I think what's clear is the IOC Executive Board wanted to send a very clear message that all steps are being considered, but not those that would penalise the athletes.
Just follow up, sumo.
Yeah.
I understand sumo wrestling had a problem, issues of female participation, which hadn't in the past come up to IOC's criteria. Could you tell us what sort of numbers of female sumo wrestlers are in the countries around the world?
I'm afraid I've just mislaid my notes on sumo wrestling, so I can't really... I can find you those answers to those questions. I honestly don't know the art. But what I can tell you is that they satisfied the conditions which that they needed to get full recognition, so we're happy now. And that normally includes universality and gender issues, but I can get you an expert from the sports team to talk to you about that. Liam Morgan. Just in
the... Hi, Mark. Liam Morgan, Inside the Games. On the boxing situation again, can you clarify exactly what you mean by the establishment of the election list and the misleading communication? Is this the executive committee members misreading your warning in the letter from...
I think there's a concern that what we have said in the past has not been properly communicated to the members. And we want to make it clear, and that's why we're issuing the statement. We'll be contacting all the national federations. We want to make it clear what our position is and that they understand exactly what our position is, which I think is hopefully from the statement more clear now.
And how exactly would you go about ensuring there's an Olympic boxing competition not governed by ABIS?
That's still a hypothetical. Let's wait for November the 3rd. But what we're saying clearly is that we will consider a number of options, but we will try to make sure that athletes can compete in Tokyo. Ed, I think, Hula, from inside around the rings.
Ed Hula from Around the Rings. In all of the IOC statements, releases about the situation with boxing, the elephant in the room, so to speak, has not been mentioned literally in any of the releases, and that's Gafur Rakhimov, the interim president. Is that the nut of the issue for the IOC, Mr. Rakhimov's election?
As you know, the IOC's ethics and compliance officer has written to President Rakhimov, and that is a letter that I can't divulge the contents of. But obviously, we have communicated our view of his position or potential position within the IEBA. But I can't really add to that. I can't discuss a confidential letter from the Ethics Commission. Yeah, Carlos.
Carlos Grobman from Reuters. Was there any discussion regarding the decision by WADA last week to reinstate RUSADA, given that anti-doping report was on the program? And also, was there any discussion on Kuwait and the development of those negotiations to reinstate the Olympic Committee? Thank you.
Yes to both of those. Obviously, the situation of the lifting of the ban on RUSADA was discussed, and it was noted again. You already know the IOC's situation on this. The decision was taken with a large majority by the executive committee of the of WADA. It follows the recommendation of the Independent Compliance Review Committee. So we take note of that. But it was discussed, yes. And by the way, Kuwait also was discussed. And I think we can say that there's been there is progress there, but there's a lot of work still to be done in terms of working out the issues with the different national federations. But Perry Miró from Olympic Solidarity is working, and NOC Relations is working hard to work through those issues at the moment. But I think we're heading in a positive direction at the moment. Yes, Eric.
Hi, Mark. Eric Bernardo, Agence France-Presse. Mark, can you explain what is the consequence of suspending the recognition of a federation? Is it mainly financial consequences? And which body would organize a qualification tournament for the Olympics, for example?
As I said before, I'm not sure that it's really for me to get into this at this stage. What we're saying is this is ahead of, in 4 weeks' time, of their Congress, but what we've said is that we will be considering some quite serious action. What the consequences would be and how it would be organised afterwards, we'll have to decide then based on what the decisions are made at the IEBA Congress. Yes, just down here.
Brian Pennelly with Around the Rings. Mark, any further news and or discussions in regard to the 2019 session there in Milan, as it looks like this Italian bid will move forward? What's the status and any time frame as to, you know, when you'll decide about that session being moved potentially?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've already kind of made our statement about that, and that hasn't really changed, which is if a Italian candidacy were to go ahead, then the Milan session would not happen in Milan. It would be organized elsewhere. But let's wait for the session to see if they are accepted as a candidate. Anyone else before I go back to Liam first and then Duncan?
Just more for, because I missed it, but what do biathlon need to do to get their finances restored? I mean, what sort of progress? I understand they gave a report to you today. How much did that satisfy the criteria that you gave?
I think the tone was largely positive, and it was felt that the new president, Olly Dahlin, was heading in the right direction. I think we still want to wait to see to get more reassurance that all the changes are going to be pushed through and that they accept and they're happy with the what we want to see, which is, you know, greater transparency and good governance. So it's withholding the payments until we're fully satisfied with that. But I would say that it's largely positive that No, I don't have one. I mean, I think we have to. I think it's a matter of kind of meeting and discussing with the new president and finding out that if we're happy with the situation. Duncan.
Going back to AIBA, have the IOC seen the K2 intelligence report that AIBA are saying they will use as a reason to ban CK Wu for life from the sport, accusing him of gross negligence and financial mismanagement? And if you haven't seen it, will you request to see it and refer it to your ethics commission?
I haven't done, but that would be a matter for Pakret Zappelli, who, as you know, is in charge of the ethics and compliance department. And so I can't tell you on her behalf whether she has or has not seen it. It wasn't discussed at the EB today. Okay. Hang on. Someone running towards the back. I have an announcement to make. Is it someone's birthday? So the press conference of the president tomorrow will be at 2, not at 12:30. And so I will see you all then. And thank you very much. Have a good evening. Thank you.